Hey everyone, this is Robert Keynes with GoldSilverPros.com. It is Tuesday, August 18th, and this is your market report for gold and silver. Let's go ahead and get right to the data. So I wanted to start off with a gold chart, and as you can see here, we've had a nice recovery the last couple of days. We got right back up around 2010 or so in the market. I think gold price has fallen a little bit while we're making the video, but it's firmly above the 2000 mark, and I expect it mostly to stay there. And with silver, we've done pretty well as well. About the same time frame, silver came back up and it's trading high 27s, low 28s today, which is good news for silver as well. I said in the past week or two, I didn't expect we'd have a large correction in gold and silver based upon the longs that were standing for physical delivery on the markets, and that appears to be true. The theme of this video really is going to be about the paper trading though, because these drawbacks you see in gold and silver price here have both been caused by paper trading. So that's the shorts coming in the market and issuing just an exorbitant amount of short positions on the market. To explain how they can do that on the COMEX, it's a futures market. It's you do not have to actually own gold silver to trade it. You don't even have to prove that you have a legitimate hedging reason, like you're a producer or a manufacturer. You can just go in and place a position if you want, long or short on the market. So you have many more paper trades controlling the futures market than you do have people actually trading the physical commodity itself. And that's true of wheat, oil, of sugar and pork and all those things on the market. And it's also true of gold and silver. So a lot of times the price covering gold and silver is done through this future market, which is a bunch of bets on what they think the future is going to be. And sometimes there's a financial incentive to take a long short or long position as well. It really has nothing to do with the underlying commodity itself. So a lot of times there can be pricing misallocations. But in any sense, that's basically how it works. Well, I wanted to look at how gold had come down for a few days, starting the second week of August here through about the 11th, and then popped back up. And you can tell that the volume here had increased on the open interest. Open interest, to reiterate for people that hadn't been following the video series, is where it's the total amount of longs and shorts in the market. It has nothing to do with the physical trade necessarily. It's just total amount of futures paper positions. And a subset of that open interest is actually going to be people trading the physical. It's usually a very small subset of that. So when people do trade the physical, and there's a lot of people wanting that physical in the market, when that number spikes, it has an amplifier effect on the overall futures market because there's so little of that compared to the overall paper betting that's going on. So, but we see a lot of an increase in these futures positions. And then of course we see the gold price fall at this time. That means more shorts are coming in. You see these two big red bars here. More shorts came in and basically hammered the price down from a high of about 2060-ish to about 1940, about $80. Now, it's not a really huge move. It is a little mini correction that occurs in bull markets, but that's the shorts coming in saying we think there should be a smaller gold price. And as long as they have money to put up for their margin requirements or their performance bond on their short contracts, they can participate. And all it takes is a little bit of cash. So it's a little bit less than, I think, $10,000. On a gold contract, put up a performance margin against these trades, and then you can take these trades on the market. And the CME Group has vetted out all the traders on the market of being generally stable financial entities. And that's why there's never been a default in CME history so far, knock on wood. But that's the way they vet them out. As long as you have a little bit of money, you can go play this game and you can control these big contracts. And that's why you have sometimes the hammering down on the short. And this hammering down on the short side happened in both gold and silver. I'm switched here now to the silver chart. And same thing happened, same time frame, same pattern. Came in on the 9th and the 11th, and then again on silver on the 12th, just for good measure, 3 days here where they hammered it down. The longs came back and the shorts came back again. So the shorts really hammered a very sharp correction down in silver, and then it started to come back. They hammered it again right here, came back down, and then it's come back up to the high 27, low 28 range. So you can see there's this battle going on. You can tell by the volume increasing here that there's this really big paper battle going on. Now, if we want to know if we're in a long-term bull market for gold and silver, you have to look at the actual deliveries of physical. So here we're looking at the month-to-date delivery notices. The August COMEX 100 gold futures, at the beginning of the month, 32,000 contracts were posted for delivery, and then fairly robust numbers for a while, and then it's kind of slowed down a little bit. And this slowing down of the standing for delivery on the long side is what's allowed the shorts to come in with this volume the last few days and really hammer that price down. But I don't think that we're going to continue to have a hammering of gold back below 2000, or it's not going to stay that below 2000 very long, because there are enough people standing for physical delivery that's basically telling the market, we're going to take that gold off the market. So shorts, if you want to come in here shorts, it's fine, but you're going to pay for it. You're going to deliver the gold for us. So when longs stand for deliver in the market, that really makes the shorts pay for taking those paper positions and makes them deliver in the physical metal. So they got to have it available. And I'm going to show later on in the video where there's not nearly as much gold available for delivery against long contracts as the COMEX or other people that cover this market may have you believe. There's some interesting data in the numbers that we'll get to. So again, going back over silver, same thing that happened. You can see the open interest in silver increase over this 10th, 11th, 12th time frame. And that means more shorts are coming hammered down. You can see the red bars on the chart and silver came down. It's really not hard to figure out the paper part of the market. It's really interesting to see, though, however, what's going to happen on the physical side. And it's December month. It's September for silver. You see all this open interest. Open interest, again, is the total amount of positions, which includes the physical and the paper. Paper dwarfs the physical. We'll get into a nice little chart that will show you that here in a moment. But the more physical there is, the higher it pushes the price up. So if we see a lot of physical delivery demands come in at the very end of August, beginning of September, on that first notice day, first few notice days of the month, then we're going to see silver spike sharply up. Same thing with gold. If you look at, but that decision month is December. So in gold, for the December contract, a lot of people come in that December month demanding delivery, even up to the December month, even over the next few months leading up to December, it's going to push that gold price up because those shorts are going to be made to pay by having to procure the physical. Now, whereas you can just issue as many longs or shorts as you can afford the margin for on the futures market, let's say you have a lot of cash in the bank, that's fine. But if you can't find physical gold, which is a much rarer asset than either cash or just these paper future positions that we're taking on the COMEX, then eventually those shorts have to pay because you can't find the gold. You can't find gold, then you've got an issue. And then the COMEX has to decide what to do. If you can't deliver on the physical gold, do they declare force majeure or do they try to force you to settle on paper, which they can based on the exchange rules? And then what happens to the actual price? If word gets out, there's not enough gold on the market, boom, you're going to see these massive upticks in both the gold and the silver price. Now I want to jump out to like a 12-year chart here for you guys just to give you a real quick update on gold and silver. You see this nice cut position forming in gold, and you see this increased volume when gold started to go up. Gold started to go up at the end of 2018. We had a 20% market correction in stocks, and then boom, gold comes up. There's a little bit of a sell-off at first because people are trying to get liquidity to handle their positions in the stock market, but then it really came up, and that's where you got the bull market. It took a stock correction. Now, we haven't had a major debt default or a major mortgage crisis like we had 2008, 2009, or a tech crisis like we had in 2000. If we see one of those, you're going to see gold shoot up to an all-time high, and you'll see the same thing with silver. A little bit difference in the silver chart. Let's blow back out to a 12-year as well, because it shows us the last time we had a major bull market. You see this major bull market happened when we had the financial crisis. And silver moved a lot more sharply than gold because silver's like, I used this analogy in the last video, gold is a tortoise. It moves slowly and steadily to get where it wants. Silver moves much more violently, much more quickly. It's the hare. So it'll stop and take a nap for a while. Like you see about 6.5 months here where it range traded between 15 and 20 bucks, dipping down to 11 there momentarily before the crisis we had in March. And then when it caught wind that the gold price is moving, the hare woke up and saw the turtle moving past it, gold moving past it, and decided, you know what? I'm putting on the wheels, baby, and here I come. So you saw this sharp movement in silver, and that's normal. Silver really moves very quickly. It moves very violently. September will tell us whether we're going to punch through this psychological point of 30. And this red line of 30 is there just because whenever you go to an even rounded number on a trade, whether it be a stock or whatever you're trading, and it tends to be a psychological resistance point. So 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50 are resistance points. 50 was a resistance point during the financial crisis, and it didn't quite punch through, and then it came down. 30 is a short-term resistance point, is drawn by this red line on this chart. But what we really need is people to stand for delivery in silver. If they stand for delivery in silver in September, this is going to shoot past it to 32, maybe 34, depending on how much is stood for and how much is actually available in COMEX, which we'll get into here in a moment. It could shoot this silver price up. Same thing for gold. If we see a massive amount of people staying for delivery, you could continue to reach new all-time highs in gold. It really depends on how much physical trading comes in the market. Again, that's December for gold. Well, leading up to December, but really December is the big month. And then coming up here next month in silver in September. The problem with COMEX is they'll give you this short-term information, you know, about a month or so of data on the charts, and it's really for traders. The data that COMEX makes available. Now they do make long-term data available for those who want to get to it in this block chart information, but you got to pay for it. And it's quite expensive. You really have to be a big player on the market to do it. The average person's not going to be able to afford to do this. And so really understanding the long-term mechanics of gold and silver is very difficult for the average person. So they listen to the talking heads on CNBC. and other financial shows are almost always wrong about the gold and silver market, and I'm about to show you why. Fortunately for those of us who don't want to spend thousands and thousands of dollars trying to get this historical data for CME, there's a service called goldchartsorus.com run by Nick Laird, and he's done a great job of giving us some very useful charts where we can look more historically at particularly gold. There's some silver here as well, but particularly gold market. The reason he's focused on the gold market is by far the bigger and more liquid of the two markets. But a lot of what you'll see in gold also follows in silver. And so I have an account here, thankfully, that we can look at this data. Now, the only drawback to using his data is I can't pull it down. I can't pull the raw data down and put a database of it together and do my own analysis after line analysis that's here. But there are a lot of helpful charts, so we'll go over some of those. A lot of people have been talking about gold and silver since the financial crisis, 2008 to 2010. And they say, well, nobody's interested in gold anymore. The price got down to 1,100, but that is an outright lie. I don't think people are intentionally lying. I just think that they don't understand the mechanics of the market. But you can see the open interest, again, the total number of long and silver short, long and short positions in gold on the futures market peaked in 2011, and it's basically stayed there. So since the last financial crisis, there've been a lot of people interested in gold. And again, this is a big boys market. The futures market is not the retail market. That's not where you and I play. You and I go to whatever retail store and we get our gold and silver because that's what we can afford. We're talking about a 100-ounce bar. You're talking about multiple 100-ounce bars. You're talking about the big boys, the institutions, the banks, the sovereign countries, miners, manufacturers, people that have really big corporate or national budgets in order to afford this. And that amount of interest has never waned since the financial crisis. So a lot of people in the mainstream financial media who are talking heads who know nothing about it, and they just read from a teleprompter, who will tell you, oh, there's no interest in gold. And that's absolute BS. And this chart basically proves it, and that's why I wanted to show it to you. I wanted to take you down to something really interesting. The last chart on this particular page, I want to show you the bottom half. This green line is the total number of contracts. That's just the paper position, and it's inclusive of those paper positions, those paper long standing for physical. So the yellow and red are two categories of physical. So you can see that the paper market definitely outweighs the physical, and it started off not being so big, and then all of a sudden paper just blew way past physical, meaning most of it, you know, we don't have true gold price discovery in the market because there's not actually a lot of physical trading going on as a percentage of the market. These are all just paper bets by people saying, oh, I want to go long or oh, I want to go short, but have nothing to do with the actual physical commodity. And you can see how much physical commodity is traded. All these paper positions don't represent true hedges. If it were a miner hedging their output, these numbers on storage and COMEX would have to be much higher, or physically trade on COMEX would have to be much higher. No, this is just speculative gambling. That's the green section. The difference between the green, the red, and the yellow is speculative gambling. Now, the red and the yellow are very interesting for a very specific reason. Registered ounces in yellow, for those who have not been following this series, are those ounces that will actually be physically exchanged for a futures contract in a given month. The eligible is not, okay? Only the registered. So registered is where people say, I've got gold on COMEX in one of these sub-depositories, JP Morgan or whoever one of these custodians are. And they say, I'm putting this forward eligible for contracts. So I have so many, you know, each of these clients, which aggregate up to these big bullion banks, will say, I've got so many contracts in which I may have to actually settle for physical. That's what I'm putting in registered. The rest goes to eligible. Eligible, all it is vault storage. That could be there. Never for the purposes of being delivered to a futures contract. It could just be safe storage because a lot of these bullion depositories that hold gold for COMEX also happen to hold gold for the clients who just want to store it in a safe place. So a lot of this eligible, this red, is not for delivery and never will be for delivery. And we've seen that in previous videos where I've showed you the actual Excel charts of the actual metal depository statistics where we see gold, like last time I did Brinks. It came straight into registered category, not up from eligible to registered, but straight off the market from elsewhere on the market into registered, meaning whatever was ineligible could never be put to a registered contract. So if Brinks and all the clients that Brinks represents need to provide gold for delivery against a futures contract, most of the time it's going to come from off markets, not coming from eligible. That means these eligible numbers are for something else entirely. These eligible numbers are not for the COMEX positions. So that means that there's a lot less liquidity in COMEX for actual gold delivery against the futures contracts than it looks like if you just look at the total number of ounces. That's key to understand. The physical available ounces on COMEX are much more thin than what people think and most of the talking heads in the financial media will tell you. You have to go look at this data to figure that out. And over time, notice a trend. Notice that this red eligible ounces, meaning the ones not available for delivery against a contract, have increased as a percentage of total eligible ounces, the red and the yellow together, to the point where it was razor thin after the financial crisis. After the financial crisis, people said, I'm putting that back ineligible and I'll play in the paper market. I'm not putting my gold for actual delivery. I'll settle in cash. Thank you very much. And it got so razor thin around here in 2016. It's like there are almost none. You've seen in 2020 how this explosion in registered has come about. Why? Because as we'll see in the next set of charts, more people are standing for delivery. So in this next set of charts, this is the gold delivery numbers. And you can see this massive amount of people standing for delivery. Last time that happened was a run up to the financial crisis, but these are even higher numbers. And we're going to get out here and look at a cumulative stop contract deliveries. Look at this spike since 2006, by far the highest number. So when you see these numbers go up, people standing for delivery, you see the gold flowing into registered. See how that matches up? Gold flowing into registered, this yellow here. And oh, there we go. Why? Because more people are standing for delivery. And you can see, however, that it's increased eligible a little bit, but the eligible is not flowing to the registered. So people aren't giving up their eligible. It's coming from off market. That's what these charts are showing us. If not, then this red and this yellow number would basically, there would be no red here. All of this red would basically be yellow. If all of the eligible moved to register was available to move to register for against the contract, you would see no eligible here. What you're seeing is money coming from off market into safe physical storage, the red, and then into registered. So again, there wasn't this thinly traded available stock, this yellow line here against future contracts, you know, leading up to 2020 when we had the financial problems, wasn't available. It was a very thinly traded amount on COMEX. Where is that gold coming from to get into registered? Well, that could be from a lot of sources, and we'll talk about that in future videos. But I just wanted to show you the stats. Now, it's interesting to see. Again, let's take since back, you know, 2018, we had a stock market crash. You see this increase in amount of open interest and this increase in amount of deliveries in green. So people are telling you people are interested in gold. Don't listen. The statistics are clear. In fact, since 2016, it's been doing nothing but going up in both cases. More open interest, more deliveries. So don't listen to the talking heads. And again, this is COMEX gold deliveries on more of like a weekly basis. In 2020, you can see it spiked. We haven't seen that. Even during the financial crisis, 2008, 2009, you didn't see this amount of gold delivery. That's because I believe they had this massive economic bubble going on that was not solved. And the crisis of 2000, the tech crisis, it was not solved. And the crisis of 2008, 2009, the mortgage crisis. And that's why more people are taking physical delivery. People on the COMEX are jockeying for that physical delivery. It's clear as day in the data. And that's what tells you and reaffirms that we have a bigger economic crisis coming. It's self-reaffirming. Bigger issues in the economy, more people stand for delivery than we've seen in two decades because they believe there's more issues in the economy. And we'll get to the fundamentals later on. People have been asking me to do economic fundamentals here in this series for a while. I'm going to do that. I'll get to that. I wanted to explain how the futures market works first. And all the futures market decisions, all of this open interest that we see in the market, all of this green here is based upon the fundamentals. People don't go in and just make willy-nilly bets and say, well, I'm just going to, you know, try to earn a couple of nickels on a futures contract without having done any data study. No, they're studying the data. That's why the open interest continues to go up. When you see open interest go up in the precious metals market, this is an indication of how much they're climbing the wall of worry in the economic markets. That's your indication. Last thing I wanted to show you, we go back even a little bit further on this chart right here to the 1970s to the eligible versus registered stocks. Again, to reiterate, if it's your first time watching these videos, registered stocks are the ones that can be for delivery against the futures contracts. The shorts have to deliver to the longs that are saying, I'm standing for delivery. How do you know who's standing for delivery? You go to the delivery reports. Right now in gold for August is 48,000 contracts. Yeah, 48,000. And that's why you see, that registered stocks going up because they know they're gonna have to deliver. So 48,000 ounces of gold. This registered number almost equals the amount of people standing for delivery. You got 48,000 here. You go to this chart and you almost have 48,000 here. See how that matches up? But notice how a lot of this is actually eligible, not registered. So it actually isn't enough registered gold at this particular moment to satisfy contracts. So what they're going to do is they're going to try to go and settle for cash. They're going to say, I know that you're standing for delivery. Can I settle for cash? Is there some incentive I can give you? Can we roll over a position? They're going to try and negotiate. Because this thinly traded dark green market of actual eligible gold to be traded on a futures contract. That's why we talked about before force majeure. Yes, there's gold sitting on the market. Let's go back to our daily inventory report for gold. If you go down to the bottom of this daily inventory report for gold, you see total registered of 16,153,000 ounces. That appears as though there's enough. But if so, why is there this spike of people trying to get gold onto the COMEX? That makes one wonder, why would you stick a bunch of gold in COMEX and put it in registered if this number were actually true and we actually had 16 million ounces available? Boy, that's odd. Why would that happen? It's not logical. Wouldn't it go to eligible? No, there's a flight to safety to eligible, but there's more that needs to be for registered. So I'm not, this is why I'm not sure I totally believe these numbers. I would rather look at historical charts than a daily inventory number to tell me what's going on. And you can see over time, when the markets first started trading, it was all registered. There was no such thing as eligible. If you stuck gold on the COMEX, it went to a futures contract. And if you didn't want it to go to a futures contract, you didn't stick it on COMEX. And that changed right after the tech crisis and virtually increased or virtually went to zero the amount of registered after the last financial crisis. As these financial crises have occurred and gotten bigger, because we're blowing these bubbles bigger economically, more people are putting into eligible and they're saying, I ain't giving up my gold for these long papers contracts until we get to a point where we may have a liquidity crisis, where there's so many contracts standing for delivery that we have to get it from off market and put it into registered. And that's clearly what we're seeing in the charts. I also want to show you that the total stockpile after we had the tech crisis, the financial crisis, the mortgage market right here, and then the 2020 crisis, there's been nothing but increased gold stockpiles on COMEX. What does that tell you? This is a flight to safety in gold that has never stopped. So regardless of what the talking heads have told you, more people are putting gold into COMEX because it's a flight to safety. Now they're either putting it eligible as a safe place to store it, or they're putting it in COMEX because there's this raging demand for fiscal going on in the COMEX. Flight to safety. I don't know how to draw a better picture of that. The economic conditions we've had building since 2000 and the activity in the gold market and how that activity is unfolding in the gold market. Clear as day. Gold is still a safe haven. I don't care what the talking heads say. I don't care what the physical price of gold is when you go into gold store. What matters are these charts I'm showing you, because these are the big boys taking bets. And this is what sets the future prices. So this is what we pay attention to. And that's why I started doing the series to educate you guys on what's going on. Last chart I want to show you guys. Again, this is another view on registered versus eligible. In 2008, at the financial crisis, all the big boys pulled all their gold off of registered for delivery on a contract, where you had almost zero in 2019, zero in 2016, almost none in 2014, and all of it went to eligible. These are the big boys saying, after that mortgage crisis, we're not so sure the economic problems were solved, so we're just going to throw all this into eligible, and we ain't delivering it on a futures contract. Hello, a clue. There's not enough gold to satisfy all those short positions in gold and silver on the COMEX. And the big boys aren't making it available because they know that we're in a thinly traded gold market, and they're not, if they release this to the registered category and increase that number, they may never get it back. It may disappear into somebody's hands and it ain't never coming back until the next big financial crash occurs. And then we liquidate in several years after that, maybe a decade after that. This is the big boys positioning to take their gold off the market. That's what that number means. And that's why you want to invest in gold and silver. You follow what the smart money does. This is the smart money saying what the hell they're doing. Follow what they do. It's in the data. That's the whole purpose of me showing you this series. Do what the smart money's doing. Well, I'm sorry, one last chart. I lied. I wanted to talk about pre-2000. There was no such thing as eligible and registered. If you put it on the COMEX, it was for trading. Okay, that's what this blue is. Stocks shown prior to 2001 are not eligible or registered. There was no eligible category. Eligible category came after the tech crisis, and it was exacerbated after the mortgage crisis, where they said, oh yeah, we want to put our gold in safekeeping on the COMEX, and we don't actually want to deliver it against a contract. Let's call this eligible. And it's confusing because it's eligible. People think eligible means eligible for future. No, look at how the market defines it, how the COMEX defines it. Only registered, and it's paper thin right now. Paper thin. This is the final step in the battle for these large amounts of gold in the market, and the data is absolutely abundantly clear. If you have not taken your gold and silver position, you may wanna take it. I can't tell you what to do, but that's what I'm doing. And I think this is what the data shows us. So this has been a very good video, because this is sort of the first big milestone we've hit in the series, where I blew it out and showed you the big picture. I've taught you how the market works. And so now you understand how the gold and silver market works. Now, as we get into future videos, I'm going to take us more into the fundamentals that are driving these decisions to help us do some more long-term planning. And I'm also going to talk about some other aspects of the market that may help clear up what's really going on. And I think you're going to find future videos very interesting. A note of housekeeping, I said that this past Sunday I was going to do a video. And on Sunday, videos were supposed to be more instructional, more in-depth. And then Tuesday and Thursday are more transactional, where we look at what's going on during the trading week. We had somebody pass away in our family that we're very close to, and we had the funeral on Sunday. And I fully intend after the funeral come back and do a video, but you know, from speaking with the family at the funeral and just realizing how important life is and how important our loved ones are, Sunday afternoon and evening, we just had family time. We didn't do any chores or any work whatsoever. We just put, you know, pencils down, keyboards down, and said, you know what, we're just going to spend time together. And that was the right decision for us to do that, you know, as a reminder, what's really important in life. So apologies, you guys, I didn't get a Sunday video out. I'll start that series this coming Sunday. So we'll get three updates in the series during the week. Sunday will be sort of a recap of past action, a preview of future action, but we're going to get more into fundamentals, and that's when we're going to do it. And then Tuesday and Thursday, I'll continue to bring these short, sort of shorter, quickie videos that you can view in 30 minutes, hopefully, or less, which tells you what's going on in the market, and it'll drop some nuggets as we go along the way to teach you how it works. Okay, it's been my absolute pleasure this time, guys. Thank you for joining. Leave comments below. I know there are going to be questions, especially if you're new to this series. If you're new to the series, go back to my June 14th video on silver, where I called the pop in silver 4 days before it happened using the data I showed you today, and then bring yourself forward. That way you can catch up on the series. I drop nuggets as we go along. And then the Sunday videos will help you catch up, because we're gonna do some more instruction there as well. So appreciate it very much for you guys. That's it for today. This is Robert Keane with GoldSilverPros.com.